We are going to get to talk about backpack sprayers from here in my home here. So going to be starting out thanking John Grandy from Rutgers. Dr. Grandy did a project looking at backpack sprayers. He came up to New Hampshire around 8-9 years ago and spent a couple days doing a couple programs, and we made a series of videos of him, and he was a great reference. He has since retired, so you still can go back to the videos to see him. Again, we're trying to put knowledge and research to work for you, the people of New England, and starting to talk about backpack sprayers. They're a very versatile tool, but unfortunately, users fail to calibrate their sprayers and really know very little about what accessories are available to help them do the job. I had an opportunity to do a program down in Peabody, Mass, at Northeast Nurseries. We had around 20 landscapers, and there was only 2 of the individuals at that meeting that knew how to calibrate a backpack sprayer. And here we were talking about spraying different types of shrubs and in a landscape situation, and talking how I would go about calibrating the sprayers for it. So in basically determining the output of a backpack sprayer is difficult, but it can be done. The output is needed to know, so you know how to mix the amount of material on a per acre basis or by a per 1,000 square foot basis. I'm not going to be talking about greenhouse use in a greenhouse situation, more of an outdoor situation during this talk. So when we're applying herbicides or any pesticides, we want to spray so that the foliage is noticeably wet, and we're going to be getting to coverage at the end after the first break, and I'm not going to give you all the information there. But we don't want to spray to the point of runoff. If we go to the point of runoff or beyond, we're actually going to have less product on the plant because the motion of the product running off the plant will draw more off than if we don't allow it get to that point. So improper spraying, we can have dead plants, wasted money, poor pest control. To be successful, you need to calibrate and use your sprayer so that you know how to use the sprayer so that you can use it to its maximum. And it takes time and practice when you're using different type sprayers. So it is a demand that you need to consider. Some of the key aspects that you have to look at when you're purchasing a backpack sprayer is the type of pump that you're looking at. Basically, you have a diaphragm or a piston type pump. You have to look at pressure regulation, the type of nozzles, or we can even put a boom on a backpack sprayer. A lot of people don't realize that. And also the tank volume. Remember, for every gallon that you put on your back, that's going to be over 8 pounds plus the weight of the sprayer. So the weight on your back has to be also considered on of the fatigue aspect of using the product. Features that are important in selecting is the pumping lever should be a comfortable position. Consider a sprayer with reverse levers if you have people that are right-handed versus left-handed. Some of the different types of sprayers is quite easy to convert. Other ones, it takes quite a bit of time and effort to convert it. You want to look at your wand, your hand grip, to make sure they're comfortable and easy, and they are a type that you can clean them to make sure that there is no particles within that wand system. The sprayer should be balanced and comfortable to wear solidly on your back. I like the ones that have a belly strap that you can tighten down so that it's not flopping around on your back besides your shoulder straps. Remember, you're going to be carrying anywhere from 25 to 70 pounds, depending on if it's a 2 or 3 gallon sprayer up to a 7 or 8 pound gallon sprayer. So that weight has to match the applicator, what they can handle. The sprayer should be stable when it's sitting on the ground. It doesn't flop over. And we'll talk a little bit more about that later. Hoses should be durable, reinforced so that they are connected to the tank that will not come off. One of the common things that I see is people not tightening them down, and you're spraying and all of a sudden you pull the hose off the tank and all of a sudden all that material is running down your backside, which I don't want to see anybody in that situation. Inline screens are available in some models that are in the handle or the tip. These reduce clogging at the nozzles, but every time you fill the tank, clean the filters and screens so that you know every time you start that it is clean. The filling holes should be large enough with a tight fitting lid to prevent the liquid from spilling onto you when you're walking or bending when you're applying the products. When you're spraying, you can either use either hold the nozzle steady at a constant height, or you can swing back and forth, or swing the nozzle in a steady sweeping motion for overlap. I personally do not like the swinging back and forth. I like to spray when I'm putting a herbicide so that when I'm spraying the ground, it is a constant uniform width and path, that I have a uniform distance from my target to the tip. Because I know that when I come back the other side, if I'm waving back and forth, I'm going to get a Z pattern that I'm over applying in part of the times as I'm going back and forth moving. So you get this Z pattern. If you practice on a concrete or a macadam type, you'll notice it when you practice as the spray hits the surface and starts to evaporate. You can see those dark Z strips on the ground. You want to maintain that uniform nozzle heights if you're spraying the ground. If I'm spraying a plant, I need a certain number of inches from the target to the nozzle so that the pattern will be properly. You have to constantly walk at a constant speed so that you're applying the critical dose. The pressure continues to drop on these sprayers that you're spraying if you have the hand pump. So you constantly have to repressure the tank in frequent intervals or with continued pumping. And we'll talk a little bit more about that in a second. Your variables when you're spraying, you have the variable of pressure. You have, and that could be how fast you're pumping will create different types of pressures, but we can take care of that by putting a control flow valve in to have a constant pressure, your speed, how fast you're traveling, your tip or nozzle size and type, and also your spray width are all influencing the rate that you're applying to any given application. All right, all will influence the rate per acre or per 1,000 square feet. Most landscapers are looking at 1,000 square feet. In our vegetable fruit, we're usually looking at a per acre basis. Back sprayers. With backpack sprayers, the nozzle height and swath widths. The nozzle height, they're talking about from the tip of the nozzle to your target. If you're spraying the ground, it would be from the ground to the tip of the nozzle. If I'm spraying plants on the ground, I'm talking about our target is halfway into the plant. So if I have a plant that is 1 foot tall, I'm looking at a target that is going to be 6 inches off the ground, then I need to have the distance from there to the tip 24 inches or 30 inches or 21 inches, depending on the type of nozzle that I'm using. Your owner's manual or the spray tip catalog will tell you what that distance should be. So I have examples of these different type sprayers. This is a piston type pump sprayer, and you can notice that the operator is pumping with his hand there on his left hand and put it on. I'm going to run that one more time. And also notice that this sprayer, that he has a yellow device at the end. And just remember what that yellow device is when we talk in a few minutes here. Now, electric power is a lot of people, or some people might use gas power. Nice and loud. Gas is even louder. Again, you can see the uniformity of the pattern that this individual is spraying. And he is moving at a solid pace or speed down the row, so that he's trying to apply a uniform amount as he is going down the road, a row of tomatoes there. And this is an air assist backpack sprayer, or some people might call it an air blast. It's called air assist because this one, it's the speed of the air going past the nozzle that creates the particle size. Where an air blast, it's the pressure of the fluid going through the nozzle that creates the particle size of the droplets. So kind of a little bit of terminology to the type. Now I'm going to show this again, but I do want to say a couple of things. This backpack, power backpack sprayer does not have a pressure compensating pump. It is a direct flow in water into the pump, and it's pumping. Notice as he goes up, around within a second that he goes up, the spray turns off. If it is a positive placement pump, you would have a continuous spray regardless of where the nozzle is, up or down. But as he puts the nozzle up, it's above your spray tank, so the water is not, or the spray solution is not running into the tank as uniform, so you're not going to get a uniform spray coverage. It costs around $150 more for the pump, but you get a better job done. So if you're going to be spraying something that you're raising your wand above the tank, you should be getting a positive placement pump for that type sprayer. But if I'm always spraying 100% of the time that something is below the tank, then you could get by it. But stop and think, if you have blueberry bushes that are 4 or 6 foot, 8 foot tall, your nozzle is going to be up, so you may need that positive placement pump. So let me show this one more time. So as he goes up, notice it starts to cut out right there. These are little things a lot of people don't realize when they're purchasing backpack sprayers, but will make your job easier and better and have a better understanding. So when we're talking about pressure, different brands have installed what they call a spray management valve or a constant flow valve in the handle or in the boom. My problem is if I go and look at the owner's manual, I cannot find how these valves are working. Some of these valves will only regulate at low pressure and does not regulate going above a certain pressure, or it regulates at a high pressure but doesn't regulate if it's below. So I always tell people that they should consider putting a control flow valve, the red and blue devices, at the nozzle so that you know that the pressure of the fluid going out of the nozzles will always be a constant pressure with that device. Regardless of high or low, it will keep it plus or minus usually a pound. I think the red one is in the area of 21 pounds. The blue one, I don't remember. I always have to look it up. It's, I think, 30 some pounds, 30 pounds or 29 and a half pounds PSI, where a yellow one is 14 and a half and the green one is 42, 43 PSI. So that you always know that the fluid is coming out at a constant rate. So then your variable is with the type of nozzle and also the speed. So having a pressure regulator is not an option. A fairly uniform can maintain with the hand pipe by operating at a certain number of pumps per minute. It doesn't work all the time. And it's not necessary to know the exact pressure of output, but to calibrate a sprayer, but the pressure must be kept constant throughout the calibration and application. So what I say, spend the $21, buy one of these CFV valve so that you always know what your flow rate is coming out. It takes out a lot of the guessing. Speed is the real bugaboo because each one of us have a different speed. And each one of us have a different speed if it's the beginning of the day or the end of the day. So we need to practice when we're spraying if we want uniformity, especially if we're spraying a herbicide on the ground, because we want a uniform application. We don't want a heavy application in one place and a light application in another place where we could be over applying, creating a problem, or under applying, creating another problem. So go out, practice. I have a couple cadence in my mind, so I know I can walk 3 miles per hour. I have a different cadence that I, a little song I sing that I go 2 miles per hour. So depending on the rate I want, I have those choices compared to the type of nozzle that I'm using. So therefore, it's important that that speed is constant, if especially putting down herbicides or treating the ground where we want a uniform coverage over a given area. Now the nozzles, you got to look at what is the job you're doing and selecting the nozzle for the job. Most of the time people think of backpack sprayers that we're putting a pesticide on, but not necessary. We could be using a liquid fertilizer application on them. And a lot of times we'll use a flood jet type nozzle because we don't need a uniform over the whole bed. We just need to have a uniform amount over a given area. The flat fan is what is good for herbicides, pre-emergence and post-emergence. It's also good for insecticides in some cases. A hollow cone is what we usually look for our fungicides and our post-emergent herbicides and also insecticides. And the reason I'm saying for post-emergent pesticide, because the plant has three dimensions. It doesn't just have the length and width, it also has a height. So we can get a better application over that plant in order to get the herbicide into the plant to do the job. If we're looking at direct spray, like a stump treatment or basal treatment, many times we're using a full cone type of nozzle. This is from T-Jet. T-Jet, which is spray systems, probably has 50 to 70% of the agricultural business. And I always go back to this chart is a good starting point in determining what we're going to do in our spraying and what type of nozzle we should be looking at. I got some examples of nozzles here. The top group is a flat fan. On looking at them, on the right side, you have a 1506. The first two digits tells you the angle. So that's a 15 degree 06 means the orifice size or the hole in the nozzle. The higher the number, the greater the number of those last two digits, the bigger the hole, the more flow through. The next one in was is a 4004. So that is a 40 degree and it's the orifice size is 4. So that's going to be putting out less than the 6. And notice this one has E. And E stands that the spray pattern is going to be equal all the way across that. You're not going to have a high amount in the middle and a low amount on the sides. So you don't need to overlap with an E. So it's an even distribution. The middle one is an 4002, 40 degree angle. 02, half the size is the 04, and it's an E. Then we have a 2503, 25 degrees, 3 means it's halfway in between 2 and a 4. Then the one on the left is a 2502, again, 25 degrees, 2, meaning a smaller orifice size. Then the bottom group is adjustable nozzles. And I have a problem with adjustable nozzles because if you're constantly turning, you're going to be constantly turning and adjusting the flow rate, and I'm not going to have a uniform coverage. So many times I tell people if they're going to use an adjustable nozzle, set it, calibrate it, and don't change it, because if you change it, it changes the calibration each time. If I'm putting on spraying a percent solution and not looking at a given rate per given area, a rate per 1,000 square feet or a rate per acre, then I can use these, because if I put a little bit more on or less on is going to be dependent upon the size of the plant that I'm spraying and the coverage I'm trying to put on that plant. So if I'm looking at a per rate per acre, I have to give a certain rate per given square foot. An adjustable nozzle is going to give me more or less if I keep changing the position of that nozzle. If you go to your tip reference manuals or catalogs, they're going to have tables. And these tables will tell you a whole bunch of information on what the flow rate is for a minute. It's going to tell you what row spacing you should be doing. This is a table for an even fan, and the table on the right bottom is going to tell you that a 40 degree that is 12 inches from a target is going to be giving you a 8-inch spray width. If you take that 40-inch spray pattern and put it up at 21 inches, that will give you a band that's 15 inches. So you can play with that, and also will give you a conversion factor for if you're having them 20 inches apart versus 30 inches apart on figuring out how much your output will be. Here's the adjustable. You can see that the high setting for the very top one at the B versus A. B is the lowest setting and A is the lowest setting and B is the highest setting. And you can see at 20 pounds, 30, 40 across up to 150, they'll tell you the flow rate of that so you can calculate. It also tells you what the maximum throw distance at the different pressures can be. So there's a lot of information that the tip owner's manual can give you. If you can figure out how to read them, and sometimes it takes a little bit of practice to figure that out. Now, here's a type of nozzle. Somebody sent me pictures and they said, what is the flow rate? And I said, question mark, because I don't have the brand. Since I have no brand, I have no idea what the flow rates are, and I can't even look them up because I don't know the brand of the tips. So sometimes even I get stumped because I don't have enough information. So when we're looking at spraying, check the nozzles on your boom to make sure that they discharge, or if it's one nozzle or two, three, or four. Clean and service your nozzles before applications to make sure that they're working properly. Ensure all your nozzles are the proper ones based on the height and the nozzle spacing that you need. Replace nozzles at the manufacturer's suggested interval. Worn nozzles waste product money and can cause plant injury. So I listed eight of the most common spray manufacturers. As I said, that spray systems has over 50% of the market. Greenleaf has a lot in the horticulture. Hydro pumps have several also in the landscape industry. Hardy has a lot in the field crops or in the sprayers. Boom sprayers, air blast sprayers. Liker also has some in boom. So each manufacturer has their own website. You can go and check out the technical information for each of the nozzles at these websites. I do have a backpack sprayer here. And this is the brand that when John Grande did his evaluation of 20 different ones, this was the one that he said that was the most efficient. And one of the reasons he liked it is it has a 3-inch pump that goes down in here over a foot compared to a Solo that is a 1.5-inch pump by around 4 inches, that you have more of a pumping surface that you can maintain. I compare this to the Solo. It takes like 17 pumps to spray out, let's say, 500 milliliters. It would take me 30 pumps with a Solo to do the same amount. So little things like that you don't think will make a difference. But if you're pumping 17 versus 30 over a day, what does that do? If you're spraying an acre of tomatoes, it's going to mean an awful lot at the end that you probably will be getting more uniformity at the end. So there's other ones that I have around 8 different brands. And so when I do this in person, I get people to try them out and actually compare how they are pumping and so forth in person. So with COVID, we can't do that. So we're gonna move on. And I wanna go to the second part of my presentation. So let me see if I can get this all going again. Oops. Share screen. Okay, calibration is the process of measuring and adjusting the amount of pesticide to a given area. Now, people usually look at this aspect and say, how much are you applying per 1,000 square feet or per acre? But that is only half the story. The other half is, what is the coverage to your target? To me, is an important piece of calibration. And we'll talk a little bit more about that. We can go down through all the different benefits of performance of the product, plant injury, reduce callbacks and cancellation, the economics of it, enhance the reputation, legal aspects, environmental, regulatory, all different aspects that we have to look at with calibration, but it's just the part to me is how well the product is doing. I always go through a pre-calibration checklist, fill it up halfway with water, inspect it, make sure all the components are working properly and that nothing's damaged. Make sure you have the right type of tips and size for the application. Want to make sure to try to test it out. And I have my good old brush here for cleaning the nozzles with a soft tip. This is what we use. Never use the wire. Because once you put a wire in that tip, you're disrupting the dimensions and the way that that nozzle is created to get uniform flow. So no metal allowed in a nozzle. If you have a clog, get a can of air and with your nozzle tip and blow out the tip reverse way, you can blow out your clog. So no blowing on the tips with your mouth. No. So I have a video, around 5-6 minute video on calibration. I think that does a good job. So I'm gonna get this going. So it takes a couple seconds to get it going. It was made at Penn State, and there's another video.
Backpack sprayers offer a convenient, cost-effective way to apply pesticides at your farm, in your garden, or on your lawn. As with the use of any spray equipment, calibration is essential to getting the treatment applied correctly. We're going to show you the basics of two methods to use for calibrating backpacks. One for treating small land areas such as lawns and gardens, and the other method for agricultural applications. Before we conduct the calibration, keep in mind that there are many techniques for backpack sprayer application. One of the most popular methods is by holding the application wand steady and off to one side, about knee high, while moving forward. Another common method is to swing the wand back and forth in a pendulum motion while you walk. Either application method is acceptable. Just be sure to remain consistent from your calibration tests to your actual application. If possible, do a small test with water on an area like blacktop so that you can see what type of nozzle pattern is being applied and so you can get a relatively accurate sense of how to cover a particular area evenly. Now to calibration. Let's start with the method for land areas like turf, planting beds, or gardens. This method is appropriate when you're using a pesticide that's applied on the basis of 1,000 square feet. An example from a pesticide label would be, apply this product at the rate of 2 ounces per 1,000 square feet. Step one, on a surface similar to the treatment area, stake out a plot of 1,000 square feet. Here we'll be doing a plot of 50 feet by 20 feet. Step two, fill the sprayer tank halfway with water. Never calibrate with actual product, so you'll not need to worry about exposure to hazardous products while you're conducting the test. Step three, record the amount of time it takes to accomplish a uniform coverage of the 50 by 20 foot plot. Make sure you're using the same operating pressure and walking speed throughout. If possible, repeat the process 2 or 3 times and use the average time. Step four, spray directly into a container, preferably one marked with fluid ounce measurements, using the same pressure and for the same amount of time it took to spray the calibration plot. This will tell you how many ounces of product are being applied in that 1,000 square foot area. Step five, with basic math proportions, you can then determine how much material you'll need to treat any size area. Let's try an example. Your lawn is 40 feet by 65 feet, or a total of 2,600 square feet. The label application rate is for 2 ounces of product for every 1,000 square feet. Your test plot time for 1,000 square feet is 80 seconds. And the amount of water collected in your 80-second test is 57 ounces. Therefore, your calibrated sprayer output is 57 ounces per 1,000 square feet. Now, in order to determine the total amount of spray solution needed, we'll use the following formula and cross-multiply. The math works like this. 1,000 times X equals 57 times 2,600. X equals 148,200 divided by 1,000. And then X equals 148.2. The anticipated total to be sprayed will be 148.2 ounces, which will be rounded to simply 148. To determine the amount of herbicide needed to be mixed with water, we'll use the following formula and cross-multiply again. So 2 ounces per 1,000 square feet equals X ounces per 2,600 square feet. Therefore, we'll need to apply 5.2 ounces. Let's just call it 5 ounces of herbicide for this treatment. Remember to account for those 5 ounces by subtracting it from the total amount of spray solution needed to treat the entire lawn. Because we'll need 148 ounces of total spray solution for the lawn, we'll add the 5 ounces of herbicide to 143 ounces of water. The next method is appropriate for application of agricultural pesticides that indicate the label application rate in gallons per acre. Step 1. On a surface similar to the treatment area, stake out a plot measuring roughly equal to 340 square feet, or 1/128 of an acre. Step 2. Fill the sprayer tank halfway with water. Step 3. Record the time it takes for you to complete the full coverage of the plot. Step 4. For the same period of time and at the same pressure, spray into a container with water from the backpack. Record the ounces captured. Because there are 128 ounces in a gallon, and our plot is 1/128 of an acre, we know that the number of ounces captured in the test is directly equal to the number of gallons per acre. Step 5. Divide the amount of pesticide per acre, based on the labeled rate of pesticide concentration per acre, by the GPA, again, gallons per acre, to determine the amount of pesticide to mix into each gallon of finished spray solution. Step 6. To calculate the amount of pesticide concentration to add to each tank, multiply the amount of pesticide per gallon by the tank capacity, or by the amount needed for the treatment site. Let's try an example. Let's assume it takes you 28 seconds to spray complete coverage of the calibration plot. After spraying into the measuring cup for 28 seconds, you collect 20 ounces of water. This amount is equal to the projected application of 20 gallons per acre. The product's label rate of application is 2 pints per acre. 2 pints equals 32 ounces. Divide 32 by 20, our GPA number, for a total of 1.6. In other words, each gallon of solution must include 1.6 fluid ounces of the pesticide concentrate. Multiply 1.6 by 3.5, the gallon capacity of your backpack sprayer, and you'll see that each filled sprayer tank should contain 5.6 fluid ounces of pesticide concentrate. Keep in mind when doing the backpack test, variations in pressure applied can skew the results. You'll also want to conduct the test using the same walking speed, nozzle tip, and filter that you'll be using for your application. Remember, proper calibration leads to positive results in pest management. Ultimately, that means savings in time and money for you, something we can all use a little more of.
Well, getting back here, the calibration process is looking at your walking speed, the pressure, your swath width, and the selected type of tip that you're using. If you change any one of these, this will be changing your calibration rate. So it's important that you realize changing tips, you've got to go back and double check. Changing your speed, you're going to have to double check. Changing the pressure, double check. So take time, spray, you know, calibrate every sprayer, every individual. Make sure that you're applying the correct amount of product. Be a responsible applicator. The equipment should be, every sprayer needs to be calibrated. Make sure you're applying the correct amount. And be right. Now, the other thing you should be doing is check the owner's manual to see if there's any special directions when it comes to the calibration. Each brand may have a slightly nuance onto it, especially some of the power backpack sprayers will tell you how they should be done. We went over the 1/28 method, which is more of putting on a herbicide. 1/28 for every fluid ounce is equal to 1 gallon per acre. So you measure out the 340 square feet. It doesn't have to be an 18.5 by 18.5. I'll take row spacing divided into the 342. So then I know how many feet a row I need to spray in order to get a 1/28 of an acre if I'm spraying tomatoes or peppers or pumpkins or any crops that are in rows. Then we want to measure how much time it takes. And then the step three is we're going to collect it in a container so we can figure out how many gallons per acre we're applying. Then we can go through the cross multiplication and figure out what amount of materials we need to mix in to how many gallons of water for the sprayer that we're using. So again, here's an 18.5 area. We take and figure out the time to do that area. We go to a container measuring how much material for the same amount of time it took us to spray the 340 square feet. And we time that, and then we'll know exactly what we're putting on per acre. Now, the second aspect of, to me, calibration, where people stop, is here. They know how much they're applying per acre, but they don't go and check how much or what kind of coverage you're getting. Is the amount you're applying getting the coverage you need? I look at, we have three different ways of doing this. We can use a dye and spray and see what the dye looks like. If it's in fluorescence, we use a black light. Or we can use kaolin clay, but the problem I have with kaolin clay is it clogs nozzles, and sometimes it's harder to get a true reading of what you're doing. And I go by using sticky, or the water-sensitive paper that I have, the five different ones. If you look at 1 and 2, the rate on 1 and 2 is too low. 4 and 5, we're over-applying in most cases. So we're looking for that number 3 is the coverage that will give us good insect and disease control. So here in a blueberry planting, I had these set up in a bush. You can see that we're getting unbelievable coverage right next to the sprayer, good coverage in the middle, and very little coverage on the right hand side of the bush. So this is telling me I could back off slightly with this sprayer, reduce maybe the pressure, but I'm going to have to spray both sides of the plant to get good coverage. If I only wanted to spray every other row, I could not do it and get the coverage that I would have good disease or insect control. So again, we're looking at, for most insecticides, 85 droplets per square centimeter. With some of the fungicides, we might be needing to get upwards of 100 droplets per square centimeter. But once we start going over that, we're actually could be applying too much. So if I'm using a larger card, you can see that the dark blue were actually, when we sprayed, a lot of the material was running off. So that was beyond the point of runoff. So one of the other aspects that when we look at how much we need for good coverage, as the plants grow through the season, many times we have to up our gallonage in order to get the good coverage. A tomato plant that is 1 foot tall, we don't need the gallonage compared to a tomato plant that is 4 foot tall on a trellis. So the rate per gallon needs to change to the rate that we're using to cover, to get good coverage to the plant. So we start out, we might need 12 gallons per acre to begin with. Halfway through the season, we might have to be up to 24 gallons, but at the end of the season, we might need to be up to 30 gallons in order to get the same coverage in those plants because the plant has grown. And to me, this is one of the fallacies that people say, well, 24 gallons will do the job the whole season. No, it won't, because we won't get enough product to cover the surfaces of our target. We need to sometimes increase that in order to get good coverage as the plants grow, regardless of its vegetable or fruit or even ornamentals. So by using our water sensitive paper throughout the season to see what kind of coverage, we can apply it and check to see how much blue we got on the card and is that enough to do the job required by the product that we're using. So I want to give you some other tips. I talked about when we're applying herbicides that we need to be a certain distance from the target. If I was using a 11004 tip, that's 110 degree angle, I need to be 20 inches from the target in order to get the right uniformity of the product on the ground. That is what the manufacturer says it should be. If I'm using a 8004, the flow rate is going to be the same, but I have to now be 30 inches from the target to get the same kind of coverage, what the manufacturer's technical sheet says it should be to get the same width. Walk a known pace so that you can constantly have the same coverage. You want to go the same speed so that you know you're applying the same amount. For hand pumps, you might want to put a pressure gauge on the wand and see how long it takes for it to drop 10 pounds or 5 pounds and how many pumps you need in order to bring it up to the level so you have an idea of how many pumps you have to do in so many seconds to maintain that pressure. Or you can put a pressure gauge at the wand to so that you can pump according to looking at the pressure so that you can maintain it. To me, the best way is going with a control flow valve right at the tip. Then you know what you're applying all the time, because it won't, if you go below that, it stops. If you go above it, it maintains it at that pressure. Okay, make sensible decisions. You can't spray a heavy winds. You want to make sure your equipment's operating good. Don't try to travel unsafe terrains with a backpack sprayer, or you can fall and hurt yourself. So make sure. I talked about John Grandy. There's all these videos that are on our YouTube video at the university. Anna will be sending this out to you later so you can look up any of these videos. There are also some short, quick tips that I made for both boom sprayers and backpack sprayers that she'll also give you the YouTube video channel for them. So take home messages. One calibration does not guarantee proper coverage for the whole season. Because plants grow, you have more surface. So you have to double check. Calibration is a three-step process. You have to do the inspection of the equipment, you have to figure out the output, and you need to check the spray coverage. In summary, calibration your equipment for proper product delivery. You want to make sure you maintain the equipment properly. You want to employ proper techniques so you get good uniform distribution. Always read your label. Apply safety. Now, there's one thing wrong in this video. I hope everybody can see what is wrong with this video. Now, did everybody see the people? That would be considered an air blast sprayer because it's motorized. He needs to be 100 feet away from the employees using that sprayer, and he was within 20 feet. So that, for worker protection, that was a no-no. So if you have to wear PPE, make sure you have new cartridges for your respirators. Make sure your gloves and boots are proper, hat and eye protection, and make sure you have the proper eye wash. They do go out of date, they expire. So remember to, with any pesticide, always read and follow the directions on the label. The label is the law. And that's it on my part. So Anna.